So, let me tell you about my life as a Christian. I'll just start from the beginning. Seems like a good place to start. I was raised in a Pentecostal family, in a Pentecostal church. I grew up immersed in a church environment. And, at first, it frightened me a little. I wasn't sure what to make of it all. But pretty soon, I came to understand that this was the way to live, and this was the way to do things with your life. I remember the first time I got saved. I did get saved multiple times. It's something that I think a lot of Christians go through. But if you aren't familiar with the practice, getting saved is when you ask Jesus to come into your heart and change your life and allow you to follow him, and most importantly to ask for forgiveness for your sins so that he will accept you into the kingdom of heaven. And for me, this happened in Royal Rangers. So Royal Rangers was a sort of Boy Scouts for boys in the Assemblies of God, which was the Pentecostal denomination that I was a part of. And I loved Royal Rangers. I thought it was the greatest thing. I loved it because it taught me so many different skills. Knot tying, making a campfire, throwing tomahawks. There were all kinds of cool things to learn how to do in Royal Rangers. And another important thing that Royal Rangers provided for me was a code of ethics to live by. They had a very elaborate code of ethics, especially for young children. And in Royal Rangers, we went on campouts and we met every Wednesday and learned new skills and learned about God and how God was an important thing for our lives and how to serve the church and serve our fellow man. And it was at one of these meetings that when I was at a very young age, probably 6 or 7, when my commander asked us if we wanted to become saved. And by this time I'd heard a lot about being saved, and so I accepted. And that's when I officially became a Christian. And from then on I made a point to live my life for Christ, and I started to develop a relationship with Jesus. And I spoke to him in my mind. I would pray, and I would feel like I would hear answers from him. And sometimes it felt like it was a voice. Sometimes it felt like Jesus was speaking to me through my relationships with other people or through circumstances. Like maybe something happened a certain way in my life, and I felt like this was a message from God, from Jesus, speaking back to me, maybe answering my prayers. That's much of how I live my life as a preteen and as a child. The older I got, the more I associated everything I did and everything in my life with God and with serving God and with understanding God's plan for me. I grew older in the church. I grew spiritually in the church. When a person says spiritual, I think they tend to mean a combination of emotion and meaning and also a literal belief in a spiritual realm that's on top of the natural realm. And I definitely believed in this, and I felt spiritual energy in my life and in my everyday interactions. I found a lot of meaning in the idea of what would Jesus do, how would Jesus act, and I felt like Jesus was the paragon of how a person should act. He turned the other cheek. He was always trying to make peace. From my perspective, there are of course verses where Jesus isn't so peaceful, but I didn't really pay attention to those verses. So probably the next big thing that happened for me as a Christian, and what I tended to see as one of the pinnacles of my connection with God, was becoming baptized in the Holy Spirit. This happened at a Royal Ranger meeting. We had been sitting and listening to a man talk about something very compassionate, something very sad. I don't remember exactly what it was, but he told us, he was talking to us about the Holy Spirit and the baptism in the Holy Spirit, and he said that we would feel the Holy Spirit calling us to be baptized, and we had to have the courage to answer that call, and we should look inside ourselves and feel inside ourselves if the Holy Spirit was calling us to be baptized. And I remember I felt this shaking in my spine, and I knew the Holy Spirit was calling me, and I knew I had to go out there. And so when he asked a second or third time if anyone had felt that calling, I went up and I started praying, and I felt overwhelmed with I can't even remember exactly what the feelings were. I don't remember if it was joy or fear or a combination, but in any case, I was immediately speaking in tongues, and I was laying on the ground, and someone was praying for me. Actually, he'd been praying for me the whole time, and I experienced very profound emotions during this, and I remember I felt like a changed person, like I saw the world through new eyes. Everything seemed clearer, crisper. I had established this strong connection with God, and it was more meaningful than it had been before. So this connection that I felt with God, this connection that I felt with Jesus, it caused a lot of meaning in my life and very strong emotions. There were times when I could feel the Spirit of God move through our service. One thing that I always had trouble with as a Christian was witnessing. I knew that we were supposed to witness. It was something that was in the Bible, but I always had trouble with it. And the only person who I ever felt like I could witness to was my best friend in middle school. But eventually, as a college student, I became convinced that the way to reach out to people was through the internet. And through the internet, you could reach more people than you could possibly reach as a one-on-one Christian. I felt like that was where God was leading me. So I hope this convinces Christians that I was the real deal. I was born again. I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I follow God in everything that I did. I truly believed, truly wanted to believe. Christianity was the most important thing in my life. As atheists, we sometimes treat the concept of God as if it has a silver bullet, as if there is just one problem with the idea of God that we can point out that will destroy it altogether as a valid concept. Even atheists who are former and deconverted Christians make this mistake, because there is often one concept about God that dealt the final blow to their belief and brought them to disbelief. But this is probably actually an illusion, and they've probably just forgotten the earlier concepts. So, you may be surprised to hear that I hope to give the concept of God the respect it deserves. I learned a long time ago that you'll never cause someone to see your perspective unless you show them that you understand their perspective. And I want to give the concept of God its fullest and most respectful treatment before showing why I stopped believing it. In the mind of any sophisticated believer, the concept of God is a mega belief. It's a belief that's held together by many small beliefs, many small experiences that accumulate and form a larger belief. If at any one time one of these beliefs is attacked, a believer can still, in their own mind, rely on the strength of the other beliefs. It's only when a sufficient number of these beliefs that form the mega belief are countered that a Christian will really start to question their faith. This is called graceful degradation. It's a concept in network theory where multiple nodes in a network can be knocked down, but the network as a whole can still stand up. For the purpose of continuing my story, I'll label these nodes. This is a simplified model of the concept of God, but I think that it covers a sufficient number of different subjects to make my deconversion convincing. Here's a brief overview of each of these nodes. I may not cover all of them. The first is logical arguments. These arguments could have been presented by someone whom the believer perceives as a reputable authority. I myself was convinced by the arguments of Gerald Schroeder, who wrote The Science of God. Next is prayer. Prayer provides a basis for belief in God through the perception of answered prayer. Next is morality. God is seen as the source of morality for Christians. Without God, there can be no morals. Next, there is the beauty of creation, whether the universe or life itself. The complexity of our material reality is a testament to God in the eyes of Christians. Next is the Bible. The Bible is seen as the divine word of God, inspired by God. It's seen to have inherent wisdom. Next is the testimony of other Christians. Other Christians bolster our belief, both by providing an example and by providing numbers. This is also related to our own experience as Christians. We don't see how anyone could believe the way that we believe with the passion and devotion and commitment that we believe and become a non-Christian. It seems impossible. Finally, and most importantly for me, was my personal relationship with God and my personal experiences of God. How can you come to not believe in God after feeling that you have communicated with God Himself? Atheists on YouTube have covered almost all of these points individually. I'm going to show you now how all of them come together to affect the single coherent concept of God in a single person's life. When I was young, I viewed prayer as a way of pleading with God to give me things that I felt I needed, like courage, or for a certain unpleasant circumstance to leave me, like for bullies to leave me alone. I'd also pray, of course, for some of the sillier things that any young child will pray for, like wishing I was a robot, or that God would help me learn how to tie my shoes, or praying that God would help my cousin and I build a spacecraft out of wood that would help us fly to the moon. Sooner or later, though, every Christian learns that intercessory prayer doesn't always work. For example, often you'll pray for something to happen, and it won't happen. Sometimes it happens later, sometimes it happens way later, and sometimes it never happens at all. Often, in my own life, I found that the likeliness of a prayer request coming true seemed to be directly proportional to the likeliness of it happening without me praying. To adjust for this, as I got older, I started to ask for things I was more likely to get. For example, instead of asking for God to make me a robot, give me superpowers, or send me to the moon, I'd ask for God's help on homework, help on dealing with a certain emotion, help for a friend in difficult circumstances. These are all things that I realized were likely to happen anyway, but I thought asking God for help might tip the odds in my favor. And I also feared sometimes that if I didn't ask for them, that God wouldn't let them happen, despite the fact that they seemed likely. Often I'd been burned by the situation of thinking that some good thing was definitely going to happen to me, only to be later disappointed that it didn't happen. And if I hadn't prayed, I would sometimes think it was my lack of prayer that caused it not to happen. However, eventually, even this type of intercessory prayer seemed all but obsolete to me, due to one creeping realization about God's nature, His omniscience. If God already knew everything before it happened, and had set all of the possible events in the universe in place, there was absolutely nothing I could ask for that He didn't already know about. Further, if He was omniscient, all benevolent, and had a plan for me, then why on earth was I trying to put myself in the driver's seat? What I really needed to be doing was trying to discover His will for my life. If God was omniscient, then He had already given me all the tools I needed to solve whatever problem I had. It was my responsibility to find those tools and His will for how He wanted me to use them. Not for me to tell Him what tools I needed and how I thought I should use them. So in this realization, I all but dismissed the idea of intercessory prayer. I submitted as much as was mentally and physically possible to the pursuit of discovering and executing what I felt was God's will. Prayer's sole purpose for me became discovering what God's will was and connecting with God personally and emotionally as a divine father and friend. In terms of my conception of God, this had the effect of moving the weight of my belief in God away from intercessory prayer and towards my personal experience and relationship with God. One thing I want you to notice is that this entire transformation happened completely within my Christian worldview. This is an important point because it highlights how my eventual transformation to atheism took years, and that during much of the time that it was happening, I wasn't even aware it was happening. From my perspective, I was just building up knowledge, following the truth, and learning about the world as any good student or effective servant of God should. I never thought that anything I was learning or thinking would eventually lead to me doubting the existence of God. As an atheist, I later discovered an in-depth study on intercessory prayer, involving 1,800 patients undergoing heart surgery. The study found no positive effect on the patients who had been prayed for. Even as an atheist, the results surprised me. Despite my own personal resolution as a Christian to use prayer solely for finding God's will, I did suspect that intercessory prayer had a positive effect, at least psychologically, just to know someone was praying for you, regardless of whether their prayers actually had some kind of metaphysical power. Surprisingly, the study found that people who knew they were being prayed for actually had more complications after surgery than those who didn't. Before I came to my realizations about God's omniscience, I was persuaded by an argument for the validity of prayer in the form of how God answers prayer. It's often said that God answers prayers in the form of yes, no, and wait. Sometimes the hardest answer to accept is wait. In their brilliant, if somewhat condescending, video, GII Video demonstrates, using a clever example, how this entire heuristic can be entirely psychological, without God actually answering any prayers. To do this, they present the hypothetical in which, instead of praying to God, you pray to a jug of milk. The jug of milk answers prayers in the form of yes, no, and wait. Assume that you pray to the jug of milk to give you $1,000, and they ask you to wait and see what happens. They present three different scenarios. In the first scenario, out of the blue, you get a check for $1,100 from the IRS, and they say, "See, the jug of milk answered your prayer." In the second scenario, 7 weeks later, out of the blue, you get a cost of living raise and it happens to increase your salary by $1,200. And they say, "See, the jug of milk answered your prayer. You just had to wait." In the third scenario, nothing happens for 6 months. And if you ask them why, they say, "We have to trust that the jug of milk knows best. Let's be patient." It's clear how all three of these scenarios can be applied to a prayer to God, to a prayer to a jug of milk, to a prayer to anything. Unfortunately, as comforting as the yes, no, and wait heuristic is, it can work without anything actually answering your prayers. But I want to reemphasize that it was my own respect for God's sovereignty over my life that caused me, personally, to abandon the practice of intercessory prayer. As a younger Christian, I had no doubt that God, the creator of all good and my divine father, was the source of all morality. Whatever was good because he made it good. Whatever was good because he had willed the good into existence. The Bible had made it clear that God wanted us to do good in his name, and the Bible was the first place that I looked to for guidance on how to act and how to behave. I'd initially grown up thinking that the Bible was something like a moral guidebook that would explain how to handle any situation in life I ran into. After all, it was God's Word, and it is true that the Bible played an influential role in my general attitude towards people. For example, I always turned the other cheek. I was incredibly meek as a child, and treated others as I hoped myself to be treated. And I didn't do obviously wrong things, such as killing, stealing, or disrespecting my parents. But I felt these ideas fell pretty easily under the jurisdiction of the Golden Rule. However, it became clear pretty early on in my life that the Bible wasn't always enough. It didn't always have specific information on how to handle every situation in my life. I always wanted to do what was right, but what was I supposed to say to people? What was I supposed to do with my time? What was I supposed to accomplish in my life? How was I supposed to interact with girls? How exactly was I supposed to interact with people in general? None of this was very clear at all from the Bible alone. This is where my personal relationship with Jesus Christ and guidance from the Holy Spirit stepped in. I would see visions, have feelings, and receive inspirations that I knew were holy. I felt the guidance of the Holy Spirit tugging me through everyday life, telling me to do this, not to do that. This became my greatest moral comfort, and reflecting back, it always felt apparent how the Holy Spirit had guided me to the morally correct decision when I had listened to it. By the time I was 19 or 20, I felt I had morality pretty much figured out. That all changed when I took a required class in professional ethics as a college student. I thought ethics were extremely important, and I felt that this class would have a valuable influence on other people who took the class. I felt that most people my age didn't have as strong of an ethical basis for the decisions and attitudes in their lives as I did, and I hoped that in the process of taking the class, I could possibly set an example for other people to follow if the opportunity arose, just as I had in Sunday school. I was, of course, open-minded to the possibility that I would learn something new, but I was pretty certain that I would probably breeze through the class without learning much. In fact, I worried sometimes that I might be downright bored with the class. I really didn't need to be told what was right and wrong. I pretty much already knew. One of the texts for the class was called Being Good. While I tried to keep an open mind, I was a little daunted at the thought of how boring and dry it would be to read an entire book about being good. I was already good. I didn't need to read an entire book to convince me to be good. All of this changed with one simple statement from our teacher. This class isn't about teaching you to be good. I know you are good people. I know that all of you want to be good. Ethics isn't about telling people how to be good. It's about helping good people make good decisions when the best decision isn't always clear. That statement completely changed my perspective of what the class was about. Something else that affected me was the way that our teacher presented positions that he ultimately ended up disagreeing with. When there were two sides to a dispute, you could never tell which one the teacher ultimately agreed with until the very end, when we all reasoned together to mutually reach what seemed to be the best conclusion. That kind of objectivity was something that I had rarely ever witnessed before, and had definitely never witnessed so much of in a single setting. It was becoming clear that I really did have something to learn from this class. What wasn't clear was whether or not my teacher believed in God. I'd always assumed that any intelligent, ethical, and open-minded person believed in God. It was clear that my teacher was intelligent, ethical, and open-minded, but it wasn't clear whether or not he believed in God. Despite the fact that I couldn't figure out my teacher's personal beliefs, God came up pretty early on in the semester. The teacher made it clear that he believed no conclusive proof could be made either way for the existence of God. But assuming God did exist, my teacher addressed God's relation to ethics in the form of the Euthyphro dilemma, which is as follows. Is what is moral commanded by God because it is moral? Or, is it moral because it is commanded by God? The teacher argued that the second possibility was absurd. For example, if things were just moral because God commanded them, then God could command anything and it would become moral. This is called divine command theory. The problem with this is that God could command rape, murder, and child molestation. And these things would not only be good, but morally required. It would make the word good meaningless. because there would be no standard by which to judge what was good. There would be no ultimate values. It would just be whatever random things God had declared were good. And this didn't align with the God that I knew. So if morality wasn't just the same thing as God's opinion, then morality was something separate from God, that God knew about, like mathematics or philosophy. And like those disciplines, God had given us the mental capability to discover morality with our faculties of reason and experience. But it was our responsibility to use them if we wanted to do what was right. One way that we learned the relevance of reason and evidence to morality was through case studies. One of the first case studies we looked at was the decision to launch the space shuttle Challenger. The launch took place on January 28, 1986. It was highly publicized because it was the first time that a civilian, a schoolteacher named Krista McAuliffe, would be aboard a NASA mission. The launch ended in one of the first major disasters of the American space program. 73 seconds into its flight, the Challenger disintegrated, killing its entire crew and destroying millions of dollars worth of equipment. Before taking this class, I'd always viewed disasters like the Challenger as pure accidents that were completely outside of our control. I never viewed the decisions leading up to them as containing any kind of strong ethical responsibility. But as I was slowly starting to realize, the ethical decisions that we made as a community reached far beyond the personal domain that I had relegated them to before taking the class. The final moral difficulty that I had to face in my own life as a Christian was whether or not I was doing things because I thought they were good or because I wanted to get into heaven. I resolved that God wanted me to do what was right because it was right, not because I wanted to go to heaven. To be truly moral, I realized that I must be willing to do the right thing, even if it meant that I would suffer the flames of hell for eternity for doing it. Nothing, not even the threat of hell, should deter me from doing what was truly right. That was true morality. I made a conscious pact with God at this point in my life. I told them that even if there was no heaven waiting for me when I died, I would still do what was right in His eyes. I knew that this was what He truly wanted from me. It became clear to me that morality was something that God wanted me to discover, not something that He would always dictate to me directly, and definitely not something that He wanted me to do for some kind of selfish eternal reward or fear of eternal punishment. Discovering what was truly moral, using my heart, my soul, and my mind, was my responsibility. It was a task that I was to take carefully and not lightly. He had given me all the tools I needed to discover what was right, but I had to do the hard work that was required to find it. One thing that always bothered me as a Christian was the apparent discord between science and the Bible. The story of Genesis, for example, seemed to be completely at odds with important scientific concepts like the Big Bang, evolution, and even the age of the universe. It was a great comfort to me in college when I discovered the book, The Science of God, by the physicist Gerald Schroeder. The Bible, Schroeder explained, was actually not at odds with science at all. Evolution was easy. God had used evolution as a way to create us. Adam and Eve were created when God gave the first evolved humans a soul. The Big Bang was also easy. That was simply what God had used to create the universe. The hardest part for me was the timeline, and this is where Schroeder's book really shined. Secular and liberal people who criticize the Bible for not providing the right time frames for the creation of the universe, as well as young earth creationists who think the Bible has the right time and that science is wrong, are both omitting from their reasoning one of the most important discoveries that Einstein introduced through his theory of relativity. Time is relative. The time experienced by a person in one gravitational or velocity reference frame is different from the time experienced by someone in another. There is no absolute time. So if we are considering How much time has really passed throughout the whole universe since the Big Bang? The time we've experienced on Earth cannot be held as the de facto standard. And Schroeder had found a reference point that actually matched up with the 6 days of creation referenced in the Bible in the form of cosmic background radiation. This radiation had one frequency based on its temperature at the beginning of the universe and had another when the Earth was formed. And if he calculated the mathematical relationship between these temperatures and applied them to time, you found that 6 days translated to 15 billion years, which is approximately the age of the universe as observed from the Earth at the present day. This knowledge excited and inspired me. This was the missing link. I remembered seeing Darwin fishes on the back of people's cars mocking Christianity in the liberal city where I went to college, and thinking, if they only knew, if they had only read Schroeder's book, they would understand that there was no conflict between Darwin and Christianity. Science and the Bible were two sides of the same coin in God's beautiful creation. There was no conflict. I fiercely argued this point on one of the forums that I frequented. Many atheists there seemed generally impressed by my arguments and the way I presented myself. A few still scoffed at me, but they also showed little knowledge or interest of gaining knowledge of the Bible, so I dismissed them as uninformed. Schroeder's argument had given me a way of reaching out to non-believers. It was becoming clear to me that the only reason people were atheists was because they thought science conflicted with the Bible. As soon as they understood why science didn't conflict with the Bible, they could believe. During this time in my life, I'd made a point of writing reviews on Amazon.com for books and products I'd purchased. One item I'd written a review for was a digital Bible I'd purchased for my PDA. From time to time, I would check back to my reviews to see if anyone had found them helpful. On one of these occasions, I came back to see another review had been written after mine. It was titled, Same Problems. After the problems of navigating in it are mastered, the reader of the Bible will find the same old problems of credibility that exist in any of the other Bible translations or formats. The talking snake, the sun and stars created after the earth, the sun placed in the sky after fruit trees are on the earth, woman created after man, rainbows not occurring until after Noah's flood, sticks turned into serpents, a woman turned into a pillar of salt, little children killed on God's orders because they were unlucky enough to have the wrong parents, and so on. I'm still waiting for the Bible translation honest enough to begin in this sort of way. Warning. Literal belief in these stories may be hazardous to your health. Bear in mind that they were written by primitive and superstitious Bedouin shepherders, ignorant by today's standards. At first, I was very perturbed by this review and found it completely inappropriate. My review and most other people's reviews had been about the navigation issues of this Bible. No one had had the audacity to write a review about the content of the Bible itself, a topic which I felt was too massive and intricate to fit into an Amazon review. But then I caught myself. This was probably just another person who didn't know that the Bible and science were compatible. Instead of judging them, I should reach out to them. So I sent them a kind email, assuring them that there was no conflict between science and the Bible, and suggesting that they read Schroeder's book. The reply I got back was intimidating. The man had been a professor in linguistics, and involved in academia for almost 40 years, and had taught in universities all over the world, including Stanford, Georgetown, and the State University of New York. He was also a former missionary. When he was my age, he said he had been equally confident about his own Christian beliefs. He told me that all changed for him when he was attending the University of Madrid and Ramon Menéndez Pidal, head of the Royal Spanish Academy of Letters and the foremost historical scholar of his time, invited him to use his private library in his home just outside of Madrid during the academic year of 1961 to 1962. Where Ramon explained to him, with ample documentation, how the Bible had been put together over the centuries. That kind of varied cultural and linguistic background, he said, enables me to appreciate the fact that there is no way for most people from the Judeo-Christian tradition even to begin to understand what they mean by the term God, unless they are at minimum acquainted with material such as found in easily accessible books like A History of God by Karen Armstrong, and Who Wrote the New Testament by Burton Mack. What physicists in general write about God is, within an adequately educated perspective, simply childish and silly from even a rudimentarily historical point of view. He said he had actually already read The Science of God, and he was not impressed. He explained how physicists like Schroeder have a tendency to reach beyond areas of their expertise, make foolish mistakes in reasoning, and show little comprehension for the cultural context of the humanities on which they are commenting. But if Schroeder's book makes sense to you, then that helps you at this stage in your life. I felt a mix of emotions in response to this letter. First, I was a little annoyed by that last statement, which I found condescending. Second, it was clear that I was completely outclassed by this man in terms of experience in theology and the humanities. Finally, this was the first time that I had felt a real challenge to my beliefs by a sophisticated, knowledgeable, and well-spoken person. It was clear to me that talking to this person was exactly what God wanted me to do. I had never heard of the books he had mentioned. I had never heard anyone say the types of things that he was saying. It was clear to me that God was bringing me knowledge through this man, and I was sure that once I had received that knowledge, God would use me to turn him back to a relationship with him. I admitted to the professor that he outclassed me in theology and linguistics, but explained that I felt the claims about physical science that Schroeder had made were important. What Schroeder was really trying to show was that the scientific biblical debate was a myth. They aren't really in conflict. Chris, one of the favorite methods of apologists is to reverse terminology. Since you're obviously articulate, may I assume that you are relatively young? My experience has been that, in nearly all cases, those as articulate as you, who present the position you do, are not old enough to have encountered the huge number of ways that that posture makes relatively little sense. To call the scientific biblical debate a myth is truly astonishing. Among educated people, the doctrinal underpinnings of the Bible have been known to be mythological for centuries. Have you read Robert Ingersoll's Some Mistakes of Moses as one example? The Tower of Babel story alone, to anyone with knowledge of historical linguistics, is monumentally preposterous. I had also told him how, in light of his opinions of the book, his statement that, if the book makes sense to me, then it helps me at this stage of my life, seemed condescending. To this he responded, I'm sorry that was your interpretation. My comment was intended, instead, to be kind. Would you be willing, by the way, to tell me how old you are and what your academic background has been? I'm 21, I said. I'm a computer science major at KU. I've taken many advanced mathematics, for example, advanced calculus, logic-based mathematics, algorithm analysis, intermediate scientific, biology, chemistry, and physics, and introductory linguistics and culture courses. Obviously, the pyramid of emphasis is upside down from the educational emphasis in yours. Still, I would hope that you don't discount my ability to reason, despite my lack of literary education and my youth. I know that many people my age effectively shout their opinions with their eyes closed and their hands over their ears, not intending to know the truth if the truth conflicts with what they believe. I assure you, I am not one of these people. If I find the truth, I take it, bitter or not. I seek the truth above all things, and if the truth is not in what I believe, I will accept it, given that it really is the truth. I plan on reading A History of God and at least skimming through who wrote the New Testament. I have no doubt that I may not have a definitive or even acceptable conception of God. It is of the utmost importance to me that I understand how other people have portrayed God and to be sure that I'm not basing my view of God off of some concept invented by an ancient culture for their own benefit, or that I'm not inventing my own view for my own benefit. I've enjoyed our discussion thus far, and I appreciate your participation. I don't know how old you are, but considering that you attended the University of Madrid in 1961, I'd say you have quite a bit more experience with the world than I do. Honestly, I've never had an intellectual discussion, other than those with professors related to coursework, with someone so much older than myself. First, with no flattery intended, let me say that I genuinely like the way you come across. I would say that you are more advanced in general than I was at your age. In terms of searching for the truth, you sound exactly like me. That's how I was when I was your age and how I still am. At this point, he did something that I found both odd and intriguing. He started firmly and almost fanatically discouraging me from having this conversation with him. Let me just say that I strongly feel that it is most often a great disservice to attempt to disenchant relatively young people regarding specific religious belief. I'm very happy that my wife and I were sincere and devout Christians when we were in our 20s and well into our 30s. That orientation focused us and served us well, sparing us many difficulties that our non-Christian friends experienced. It is not to your advantage that I go on in explanations along the line that I have been. For you, if you're generally happy with the religious faith that you have, it's probably very important for you to continue in it and not sweat the details. Ultimate truths aside, there's little to be gained by going from the religiously questioning frying pan to the, oh, so that's how it works, fire. Someone with your quality of mind is going to find the answers if they keep digging. But if you're comfortable in your faith, and especially if you enjoy the company of your fellow believers more than the company of non-believers, then please, just accept the subject matter the way it is being presented to you by your pastor or priest, and concentrate your efforts on your studies. I recommend that you not worry about evidence one way or the other, and concentrate on the rest of your life, career, family, or whatever. Sorting out religious teachings and history is a quagmire that can only disrupt your peace of mind toward your career goals at this stage of your life. I think that it is not in your best interest to know how I think, especially since you do appear to be able to grasp my explanations. If you find Schroeder's explanations satisfactory to you, then stay with them. I was a bit perplexed. In all honesty, I don't feel that my state of mind is as delicate as you're implying. I can't just jump off this path. I feel that this is the direction that God Himself wants me to take. I do love the people of my church, but I feel they are on a different level rationally. I think they fear the dark waters that I walk into, fear punishment from God, or they've just deduced that no good can come from it, which I have found time and time again to be wrong. They fear science and shun its ideas. In effect, I feel they've turned their backs on truth that is right in front of them. But the cause isn't lost. I learned from them spiritual lessons that I hadn't uncovered myself. They're wiser than I first imagined. And I think the more I get to know them, the more I'll discover what they actually know. And just as it may be a disservice for you to share your fire with me, it may be a disservice for me to throw them into my fire, at least just yet. That last comment reassures me that perhaps you're okay for the path you're on. But be prepared to come to see most of your current church associates as deluded automatons and mental children. The fact that you see them on a different rational level than you is a very wise observation. Religions are not meant primarily to serve people like you and me. They best serve those whom you're describing. So I suddenly felt guilty about what I'd said about the people of the church. Most of them are on fire with love and open-mindedness, even rationality. When I said it was on a different rational level, I didn't necessarily mean a lower level. But different levels must differ in height. Maybe I should have used a different analogy. Rational rooms, maybe. I was struck with this dilemma. Unfortunately, I could see what he was saying. I knew that essentially I was no different from the people of the church I was referring to. We're all human beings. We're all children of God. But I also could not deny the reality that there was a difference between the way that they thought and the way that I thought. And I could not deny that I felt that my own position was more rational and more educated than theirs had usually been. I felt like they were more often fueled by their emotions and personal needs than by a search for truth than I was. I felt like they often gave up on searching for the truth sooner than I did. I resolved that While there was nothing holding the people at church back from taking the rational steps that I had, the reality was they hadn't taken those steps. Yet. I felt the presence of God pressuring me further to speak to the former Christian from my emails. I would walk further into my journey. Through God's will, I would learn and grow further. Not all Christians were alike, and I knew that God was using the journey of this former Christian to strengthen mine. Many passages from the Bible had always had great meaning for me. For example, there was Matthew 7:6. Do not give dogs what is sacred. Do not throw your pearls to pigs. If you do, they may trample them under their feet and then turn and tear you to pieces. This had great meaning to me when people who I tried to reason with simply could not appreciate my careful explanations. I realized that they simply had not reached an advanced enough level to appreciate what I was saying. Then there is Proverbs 3:5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. And Romans 1:22. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. These verses help me understand why some people rejected Christianity despite being highly educated. They also reminded me to humble myself when I thought I had a better solution than what God was offering me. I kept these verses and many verses in my heart to guide me and encourage me in times of doubt and uncertainty. However, I also realized that I had never taken up the task of reading the Bible from cover to cover. In my second year of college, about a year before I met the professor, I felt that I had finally reached the literary ability to do this. Also, after reading the Signs of God, I had a renewed vigor for learning the power of Scripture. I started in Genesis, immediately following the verses that had been validated by the Science of God. These chapters were about Noah, Lot, Abraham, Jacob, and Joseph. One thing I learned that bothered me was that Abraham had asked his wife Sarah to lie to the Egyptians in Genesis. He did this because Sarah was very attractive, and Abraham was afraid that the Egyptians would kill him so they could take her. This seemed like immoral behavior in and of itself for a servant of the one true God. Why would Abraham lie when he had God on his side? The Holy Spirit had guided me to always tell the truth at all times. God would rescue me if the truth had gotten me into trouble. Telling a lie could never be right. But what was worse was that, after the Egyptians believed Sarah and took Sarah to Pharaoh as a wife, God punished Pharaoh with diseases because he had taken Abraham's wife. This seemed completely backwards to me. Shouldn't God have punished Sarah and Abraham for lying? Again, the Holy Spirit had made it clear to me through spiritual feelings that lying was always wrong. I encountered other behaviors from the God of the Old Testament that just didn't make sense. One was when Moses had asked Pharaoh to let the Hebrews leave Egypt in Exodus, and God had hardened Pharaoh's heart. Why would God do that? Didn't that violate Pharaoh's free will? Didn't that defeat the purpose of God telling Moses to ask? Didn't that just keep the Hebrews enslaved longer? Wasn't that unfair to the Egyptians too? God had killed all of their firstborn sons and inflicted them with plagues because of this. Wasn't this unfair if God was just using Pharaoh as a puppet? After trying to answer these questions for a few minutes, I decided that I just didn't understand what God was trying to do and reminded myself not to lean on my own understanding. After finishing Exodus, I moved on to Leviticus. I was dismayed to find that the book was filled almost entirely with rules about how to do sacrifices. I had known that God had told the Hebrews to make sacrifices from stories like Cain and Abel. However, I also knew that through the ultimate sacrifice of Jesus Christ, we no longer had to make sacrifices to be forgiven. What overwhelmed me was the amount of detail God had put into explaining how to do the sacrifices and offerings. One set of verses from the second chapter of Leviticus read, "When someone brings a grain of offering to the Lord, his offering is to be of fine flour. He is to pour oil in it, put incense on it, and take it to Aaron's sons, the priests. If you bring a grain of offering baked in an oven, it is to consist of fine flour, cakes made without yeast and mixed with oil, or wafers made without yeast and spread with oil. If your grain offering is prepared on a griddle, it is to be made of fine flour, mixed with oil, and without yeast. Every grain offering you bring to the Lord must be made without yeast, For you are not to burn any yeast or honey in any offering made to the Lord by fire. Why would God care about such mundane details? God had always taught me to rise above the mundane and see the bigger spiritual picture. I didn't see how these details could possibly have value for my spiritual life. After several chapters, I tired of the mundane and repetitive details in Leviticus and moved on to Numbers. Here too I found tedious details, this time about counting the numbers of Israelites that were from different tribes. After that, it returned to offerings and sacrifices, like Leviticus. I skipped to Deuteronomy and found more tedious law codes. All of these rules and laws were antithetical to the idea that God's law was written on our hearts, as explained by Paul in Romans. For when Gentiles, who do not have the law, by nature do the things in the law, these, although not having the law, are a law to themselves, who show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness. When I had started reading the Bible from cover to cover, I expected to see the lessons of the Holy Spirit that had been taught to me confirmed through Scripture. Instead, I was finding the Old Testament to be, at best, almost completely unrelated to them, and at worst, antithetical to them. But then I thought, maybe all these numbers and seemingly tedious and meaningless commandments had some kind of pattern that could be connected to science by someone like Gerald Schroeder. Or maybe they showed how difficult it was to serve God before Jesus had made his sacrifice and changed everything. I felt that maybe the Holy Spirit was directing me to read the New Testament. I'd spent a lot of time studying Acts and the epistles. One of my favorite verses was from Acts 1:18, with the reward he got for his wickedness. Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open, and all his intestines spilled out. While it was violent and horrible, the greed and total lack of remorse that he expressed in the passage showed that Judas deserved this death. The Holy Spirit had given me an image of his death, of Judas walking into the field, then falling forward suddenly, his intestines gruesomely exploding from his abdomen. This was evidence of God's justice and palpable wrath against the wicked. Judas had thought he had gotten away, but God had tangibly and forcefully struck him down. While I'd spent much time reading the red letter quotes of Jesus in the Gospels, I'd never read the story for myself. Of course I knew the story, but I'd never followed the details. So this is where my next journey in the Bible took me. After a few evenings of reading, I finally reached the end of Matthew, where Judas betrayed Jesus. I looked forward to reading Matthew's account of God's wrath against the wicked and remorseless Judas. I finally reached the point where I expected that to happen, in Matthew 27:5. So Judas threw the money into the temple and left. Then he went away and hanged himself. My tongue caught in the back of my throat. My chest seized up, adrenaline rushed through my body, and my heart pounded. It felt as if the very fabric of reality itself was tearing apart. It felt like the paint on the wall surrounding me would tear open to reveal an empty darkness. Everything I had believed laid vulnerable on an altar, waiting to be pierced, waiting to be sacrificed to this horrifying moment of realization. This Judas was not remorseless. This Judas seemed filled with guilt. So filled with guilt, in fact, that he hung himself. God had exercised no wrath against him. He had felt so guilty that he hung himself. I panicked. I turned back to the verse in Acts, then back to the verse in Matthew. I braced myself to face the consequence that my entire religion was a mistake. For 4 hours, I let the verses occupy an uncomfortable residence in the back of my mind. I tried to go about my day. I tried not to think about them. But eventually, I couldn't take the cognitive dissonance any longer, and I turned to the internet. I found an apologist's explanation, and held my breath. Judas, they explained, had hung himself in the field, and then his intestines had fallen out, after he had decomposed. It made sense, I guess. Maybe I'd just been wrong. It still didn't explain the feelings I'd been given by the Holy Spirit about Judas being remorseless in Acts, and the sense that he had been completely remorseful in Matthew. Or that God had expressed his palpable wrath in Acts and had been completely absent during Judas's death in Matthew. But then again, maybe I'd just been wrong. Even though I had at least tentatively accepted the apologist's explanation, my faith in the Bible as a clear and simple source of truth had been shattered. While I continued to have faith in the Bible, I never looked at it quite the same way again. In the back of my mind, I had slowly started to realize that, at best, the Bible was something that required very complicated explanations and intense research to understand. And at worst, it was the fallible word of men who may have written it to fit their own purposes, or at least made some serious mistakes. After this experience, the Bible is no longer the clear word of God that flows straight from his mind to mine. It suddenly required the intervention of outside sources to rescue it from being misunderstood. It could no longer stand on its own. I still had faith in the Bible. I just couldn't look at it the same way anymore. After a year had passed, the nagging doubts I'd had about the validity of the Bible had faded from my mind, if only because I'd stopped thinking about them and instead focused on expanding my knowledge of the world through experiences like my ethics class and debating with atheists about the validity of Schroeder's book on the forums I frequented. I was still pretty sure the Bible was divinely inspired and that the apologist's explanation had been correct. Even if there were some errors in the Bible, I was confident that overall, it was a remarkable source of knowledge. The professor did not share my belief. Genesis is demonstrably in error regarding such fundamentals as the alleged order of creation, in addition to the fact that two different orders are presented, but this makes little difference to those who are not sensibly oriented. For example, I have good friends, ostensibly educated, who believe in the literal truth of a universal flood at the time of Noah, despite the fact that there are 35,000 known species of spiders alone, with likely at least that many out there still to be discovered. The Old Testament also conflicts with common sense for those who possess it, even in such obvious observations that the highest intelligence in the universe probably would have come up with a better solution to young boys teasing a prophet regarding his hair loss than to bring bears out of the woods to maul them. Surely, the Israelite conception of God as a being who would order Moses to kill all of the Canaanite children would not reasonably qualify as a proper conception of highest intelligence. There had been a time in my life when these verses about killing did not give me much pause. I had been aware of this perspective in the Old Testament, and I had been ready, if ever called upon by God, to kill for him. To kill anything and anyone he demanded be killed, even a child, because this is what true obedience demands. Yet, even then, in the back of my mind, I'd always been uncomfortable with these verses and avoided them. I couldn't explain them. Even in a time of my life when I could coolly accept these verses with an unnerving obedience, something just felt wrong about them. But if this was God's word, who was I to question it? That was the biggest veto that I had to any objection raised to the Bible, whether by my own mind or someone else's. God had written this. It had to be right somehow, and we had to follow it. It had been my belief that the Bible was revealed to the individual writers of each book by a mass revelation filled with wisdom and absent of mistakes. There had been no need for editing by later authors, or even thinking by the first authors. These words were communicated straight from the mind of God to the men who wrote these words down. That is what made them different from other books. That is what made them holy. It had also been my belief that the Bible was the only source from the time in which it was written. It was my belief that the Bible had been passed down to us through the ages, unaltered and perfectly intact as each new book was written. And as the only source from its time, we had no reason to doubt that it had been divinely inspired. I believe that it was a mystery to academia how and when the Bible had been put together. Since I was young, I had always been told by pastors and evangelists that any scientists or other intelligent people who had tried to prove the Bible wrong had always ended up proving it right and becoming a Christian. These stories filled me with a sense of joy and glee that I was privileged to know the truth. But suddenly, the professor was telling me a different story. He had said that he'd been shown, with ample documentation, how the Bible had been put together. He had also pointed me to a book called Some Mistakes of Moses, which I assume pointed out errors that Moses made in writing the Torah. But, I argue, does the fact that Moses made mistakes in writing the Torah imply that the entire writing is a myth, completely and utterly fictitious? And how do I know that the Tower of Babel story wasn't just mistranslated? Since you know Hebrew, you could probably tell me. Gerald Schroeder had revealed that many passages of the Bible could be understood in scientific terms with the proper translation of the original Hebrew. The professor responded, Chris, the Torah was not written by Moses, nor by any other one person. Also, mistranslation is not the problem. The creation of illusion by historical manipulation is the problem. These statements perplexed me. I'd never heard anything like this before. Yet, here was a linguist who knew Hebrew telling me that the stories had not been mistranslated. What was more was that he was saying that the Bible had been written in a way that it intentionally manipulated history, and he had provided evidential sources for these claims. The statements that struck me with the greatest feelings of uncertainty were the ones about how the Torah had been written. I later learned that what the professor had been talking about was called the documentary hypothesis, which stated that the Torah had been written by at least 5 different authors, according to the Bible, with sources revealed by the biblical scholar Richard Friedman. Each of these 5 authors can be identified by 6 independent pieces of evidence from the Hebrew text of the Torah. The linguistic dialect of Hebrew that is used by each author, where each dialect is separated by decades of linguistic evolution. The unique terminology used by each of the authors. The type of content they each chose to include. The smooth narrative flow of a single author's story when the other author's stories are removed. The connections that can be made between an author and a different biblical author who is believed to have lived in the same time frame. The political goals that can be inferred for an author that give hints to which time frame they lived in. All 6 sources of evidence converge to match each individual author. I was a little stunned by the professor's statements, but I was still skeptical. How do I know this isn't just your opinion? He responded. Chris, there are very few things in this world that aren't opinions, but there is a difference between normal opinions and informed opinions. Some opinions have a higher quality than others. I realized he was right. I was defending my Christianity as if it was correct by default, as if I could assume it was true unless someone proved it was false with evidence. But I was beginning to realize my Christian beliefs, and in particular my beliefs about the construction of the Bible, were just opinions. And unlike the opinions of the scholars that the professor was referring to, my opinions weren't based on direct evidence. In fact, compared to what the professor knew, my opinions about the Bible were based on hearsay and assumptions. I'd just always been told in Sunday school that the Torah had been written by Moses. No one had ever shown me evidence from the Hebrew text to support this. No one referred to archaeological studies or higher criticism. None of it was scientific. I didn't even know there were scientific arguments that could be made about the Bible's origins. I'd always just assumed that it was all a mystery to everyone. But now the professor was showing me how deep and fatal my assumptions were. I'd been assuming a lot of things. There were academic answers to my mysteries that made them cease to be mysteries at all. And if the Bible had really been written this way, I was having a harder and harder time justifying why it was divinely inspired and other books weren't. If multiple authors had written and edited the Torah, had thought, constructed, selected, combined, and compared texts, then this was strong evidence that they were thinking. And if they were thinking about what they were writing, then what made the construction of the Bible any different from the construction of scientific papers, legal documents, and fiction novels? My confidence in the divine construction of the Bible had been undermined to the point that I could no longer confidently use it as evidence against the professor's arguments. But even if the Bible was not the Word of God, that didn't mean that God himself didn't exist. Far from it. I knew God was real. I had spoken to God myself. It was God himself who led me into this conversation with the professor. And I would prove it to him. Since I was young, I had been taught to see God in everything. Any miraculous event, any scientific wonder, any mathematical intricacy, any fortuitous personal interaction, all were assigned ownership to God. God was the source of all beauty, all power, and all knowledge. Anything I experienced, both good and bad, was because of Him, and all things led to His glory. All things worked out for the best through Him, even when they seemed bad. Ultimately, God's hand guided everything, including my life. It was from a young age, after I accepted Christ into my life, that I began to feel guided by God. Any intuition I had that led to greater things in my life was assigned to God. Whenever I could see clearly through a situation in my life, I knew it was because of God. I learned to associate any numinous experience with the guidance and presence of God. I learned to associate the insight I received in both prayer and thought with the guidance of God. In fact, sometimes this guidance felt so personal that I could literally feel Jesus' presence, like He was sitting next to me or in my heart, just as the Bible says. Jesus had knocked on the door of my heart and asked me to open up, and I had done so. Jesus lived in my heart and affected every action I took. All compassion, all wisdom, and all faithful efforts were all channeled through the example of Jesus Christ. Sometimes, when afraid, lonely, or distressed, a voice spoke to me, comforting me, guiding me through the labyrinth of my own mind. I came to associate this voice with God, and it spoke to me often in times of great distress. Like a guardian angel, this voice protected me from my own fears. When I became baptized in the Holy Spirit, I associated this particular aspect of God with His Holy Spirit. I learned that this voice I'd been hearing my whole life was the Holy Spirit's voice. After becoming baptized in about the sixth grade, my focus on this voice and its guidance became intense. This voice seemed different from my own internal voice because it spoke with a ring of authority, and everything it said seemed profound, insightful, and important. Whenever I heard a voice like this, I labeled it as God speaking to me. I became focused to the point of obsession on guidance, and learned to see guidance not only in this voice, but in the actions and words of those around me, from the text of the Bible, and from visual images that would pop into my head. I was certain that, just as the writers of the Bible had been inspired by God, so was I. These images were my guide, and the things they said had to be discerned with careful thought, prayer, and discussion with others. These images were powerful and carried deep meaning. They were one of the most frequent ways that I felt God communicated with me. It became difficult sometimes to determine whether the images I saw were coming from God or my own imagination, but I always knew which was which because of the feelings associated with them. I came to believe that Holy Spirit images were those which I felt at church or were associated with religious themes such as God's will or the Bible. These, I knew, were the Holy Spirit. I felt God's tangible presence in church. When we were all together, sometimes the Spirit moved through us. I was sure that this was God, and that anyone who saw this would see God and know God was real. I felt God's presence personally when I prayed for the Holy Spirit to return to me and cause me to speak in tongues again, which is something I did almost every night for almost a year after becoming baptized. By the time I reached college, I was certain that God had guided me throughout my entire life, and boldly shared this fact in my introductory speech for my college communications class. When speaking with atheists in online forums in college, I felt God would lay specific words on my heart to share with them. These words would come in a jolt of inspiration and clarity, where I felt God would show me precisely what to say and what words to share. This feeling guided my every word with the professor. These perceptions of a personal relationship with God were my strongest evidence that He existed. To me, my experience of God was every bit as real as the visible world around me, as real as the people I saw, the papers I wrote, or the wonders of the universe. For me, this experience was reality. Given what I felt was my unusually strong focus on my Christian faith, I at first thought that maybe I should strive to become a pastor, an evangelist, or a missionary when I grew up. However, I was a very quiet person, and I wasn't sure if these matched my personal life. Also, I felt that God's guidance had led me quite directly to the pursuit of technology, science, and thinking. I also felt that these creations of God had been neglected by the church community at large. So, I felt that I led a unique ministry in my life, one connected to my love of technology. I was sure that God would use this interest through me to communicate His will in a new way that would reach the 21st century. One of the strongest things I felt God was guiding me toward was creating a video game that would glorify His sovereignty over Earth, and specifically the spiritual realm through which He guided us. To create this video game and cause it to reach any kind of broad audience, I had to get a degree in computer science. To get this degree, I had to undertake many classes, and through these classes, my knowledge and awe of God's wondrous universe grew. Throughout these classes, I followed the guidance of the Holy Spirit closely. I followed the images and voices I received in prayer and in thought, and perceived these as God's will. Despite seeing people fail all around me in what turned out to be a very difficult and technical degree, my devotion to attaining knowledge through God's guidance always seemed to get me through. This strategy appeared to work flawlessly for me throughout college, until my junior year, ironically the same year that I met the professor. A few months before meeting the professor, I was suddenly experiencing an unprecedented failure in my coursework through a statistics class that I was taking. In response to these failures, I had only heightened my devotion to prayer and seeking God's guidance. I read the Bible diligently, seeking the wisdom of God that had been shown by Paul in the New Testament. I went to church and tried to see God's guidance in my fellow Christians, but most of all, I listened for that voice and looked for those images that seemed to have guided me throughout my entire degree up to this point. But nothing was working. This was the first time that this had ever happened in my life. God's will had seemed so clear when I was younger, but suddenly nothing was working. Suddenly God's will seemed hidden from me. Nothing seemed profound. Nothing seemed important. Nothing seemed like it had the clear marker of God's will. I felt lost in an ocean of information. I felt like I couldn't discern God's will anymore. Like learning about the world through my coursework had suddenly made the world more complicated. The only time I felt any kind of passionate fire in my life that was indicative of spiritual growth was when I talked to atheists. Because of this, I became obsessed and devoted to speaking with atheists. It was the only time that I felt God's authoritative voice, clear images, and deep passion return to me. This was becoming my new ministry. I was worried about the unprecedented failures I was experiencing, both academically and even in my personal life, in which I had few friends and felt that I was failing at establishing romantic relationships. I was worried about no longer feeling that I could clearly discern God's will. I was worried about the fact that I no longer seemed to feel anything when I went to church, and that I no longer felt the Holy Spirit pushing me to speak in tongues. I was worried by the fact that when I did speak in tongues, it no longer seemed to feel special, but rather, for some unknown reason, it suddenly felt hollow and rehearsed. But I clung to the experiences that seemed to still channel God's presence and His will, and debating atheists was the only place that I felt this anymore. It was the only time that I felt I was still growing. It was the only time that I felt I was shining. So when God had sent me this dialogue with the professor, I clung to it. It was the first time in years that I felt God was sending me clearly and fully into a trial of the Spirit that would harden and strengthen me. Like a crucible, I felt God's pressure and strength reforming me. I entered the conversation with full confidence that it was God's will. It was the only thing that God seemed to be guiding me toward anymore. It was with this profound passion and buildup of meaning that I had felt throughout my entire life that I expressed in a single statement the deep experiential reality that I felt the presence of God had been in my life, despite anything the professor was saying about the Bible. Even if the entire Bible were a myth, it doesn't change the fact that I have communicated with the mind behind this existence, and I call that entity God. If I have come to know Him through an illusion, then it was for the greater good, because he used that illusion to bring me to him, regardless of the illusion's intended purpose, if a hidden purpose was intended by human creators. The professor's only response to this deeply meaningful personal statement of faith was, "That is a very profound and beautifully worded statement." No one had ever responded to my statements of faith this way. All my life I had experienced one of two extremes. Either people completely agreed with my statement and shared their own love and experience of God with me, or people completely disregarded my statement, called it rubbish, and called me delusional. In a single stroke, the professor had simultaneously given my faith sincere respect and negated its intended power. That is a very profound and beautifully worded statement. But maybe that is all it was. I suddenly faced the possibility that the beauty I saw in the Christian religion and my perception of God was just beauty. Like carefully crafted art, or carefully crafted words, maybe beauty was all it was. Like a poem, or a story, that was deeply touching, but not true. The professor was able to show respect for the power of my beliefs without actually believing them himself. This response was both new and deeply troubling to me. But I soldiered on. I knew God was real, and that he would save me from even the most troubling realizations. I know that even if I end up fallen and burning in the fire you speak of, God will lift me up. The professor responded, still trying to discourage me from my conversation with him. "But Chris, that is exactly the kind of faith that may well disintegrate as you search on. Your entire universe of perceptions and values could be upended." "But," I retorted, "going on anyways is exactly what faith is all about." Also, unlike the professor, I knew that going on with the conversation was all I had anymore. If I turned back, I would only be returning to my increasingly troubled and hollow church life and waning connection with God. This conversation had become my only lifeline to connecting with that passion anymore. It was the only way for me to see God's face again. I would not stop. I had no choice. This conversation was the only way for me to see God's will anymore. And so the professor finally gave in, fully and completely, to my request for him to tell me what he really thought about God. I stood strongly, certain that God would rescue me somehow, certain that God would show me something the professor hadn't already seen. For 4 intense days, I wrestled with his beliefs. I tried to find holes in his arguments and his experience. I tried to tell him things about God he'd never heard before, but I was failing. Nothing I said seemed convincing to him. For every one hole I tried to reveal in his logic, he revealed 5 new holes in mine. What was most disconcerting to me was that my original statements of faith had seemed to have no effect on his beliefs. The Holy Spirit did not seem to be reaching the professor through me, despite his open-mindedness and honesty. This was further troubling evidence to me that maybe my Holy Spirit experience had been hollow and imagined. While this gave me pause for a moment, I ignored the observation and battled on, certain that my faith would save me. I told him that I was trying to wrestle through 65 years of experience to find holes, and that it was extremely difficult. He told me that what I was trying to do was counterproductive. He said that, given the fact that he was clearly more educated and experienced with these issues, I needed to sit back, relax, and take notes. I had to fully understand him before I could really think I had any grounds for dissecting his beliefs. I agreed with him. So I sat back, relaxed, and listened fully and intently to what the professor had to say before trying to rebut him. So he began. "The concept of God is intricate and profound. If it were real, it would have drastic implications for the world we live in. But in all of academia, through all disciplines, we have found no reason to believe that it is anything more than a concept. Given what we know, God is just a concept." The professor's words echoed the sentiment of the philosopher Jean Baudrillard, whose work I had briefly encountered a few months before. Baudrillard defines the term simulacrum as something that is only an image of something either real or imagined, but that is interacted with as if it really is what it represents. This interaction can be referred to as a simulation of what a real interaction with the real thing would be like. So for example, if someone wears a pendant and believes it is lucky, the physical pendant has become a simulacrum of a magical pendant. To the wearer, it represents the idea of a magical pendant and is treated directly as if it were magical. When a person believes that the pendant brings them luck, they are simulating the experience that the pendant actually is magical. The physical pendant itself can be completely mundane and have no magical properties whatsoever. But to the wearer, who is simulating a magical experience in their mind, otherwise mundane but fortunate events are perceived as expressions of the pendant's power. One can think similarly about idols that are prayed to as if they are direct representations of gods, or pictures, possessions, or internal images of deceased loved ones. They are spoken to as if they contain that person's consciousness. According to Baudrillard and the professor, God himself, as experienced by the religious, was probably just another simulacrum, an image, representing the concept of a supreme supernatural being. Religious followers simulated an experience of this supreme being in their own mind, by the way that they interpreted otherwise natural events, but this experience most likely involved no actual supreme being interacting with them at all. So when I experienced profound emotions due to what I perceived as the Holy Spirit, I was, according to Baudrillard, just simulating, subconsciously, in my own mind, what I would feel like if the Holy Spirit actually existed and was reaching out to me. I experienced real emotions, but they were in response to a simulated experience. It felt real because my mind made it feel real. Our brains, apparently, are profoundly adept at creating simulations for our consciousness to experience. As far as I can tell, based on the literature, the professor continued, the primary psychological function of the concept of a personal God is to give the believer a surrogate parent. Some minds are able to become independent of parental figures. Others cannot, or fall into self-destructive behavior without them. Minds in this category rely on religion. The God concept is useful for motivating and pacifying others, but it is not a reality that someone like you or I should accept for ourselves. While I wouldn't just accept these hypotheses uncritically without checking into them myself, I was seriously taken aback by this line of reasoning. I had never thought much about the possibility that psychology could explain my experience of God. Now that the professor had pointed out the relevance of psychology, this line of reasoning was so obvious to me that it was devastating. Was the voice of God I'd heard my whole life simply my own voice? Was my own mind behind all these profound statements? Was my own mind the subconscious force that had guided me through this conversation? Was every image and voice I'd seen or heard the result of my own imagination and reasoning rather than just some of them? Was my relationship with God suddenly failing because the simulation was breaking down? Were all the God concepts just illusions? These possibilities were both frightening and devastating, but I would not give up this easily. I still had so many other reasons to believe in God. Didn't I? Do you see how it is possible that all of this, the entire history of religion, the entire history of the world, the entire history of the universe, and your entire religious life could have happened without God actually existing? As I read this question, my mind walked through all the arguments I had made for God throughout my life. I had always assumed that the reason my intercessory prayers were not answered with a supernatural frequency was because intercessory prayers contradicted with God's omniscience. I assumed that an omniscient God already knew what was best for me, and that it was me who needed to listen to Him, not the other way around. However, I could see how it was possible that my intercessory prayers weren't answered because there simply was no God there to answer them. I had always assumed that morality was independent of God because otherwise it would just be a meaningless expression of God's opinions. Because if that were true, God could command things like rape, murder, and child molestation, and they would become moral. I had always assumed that we discovered morality through reason and experience because God had given them to us. I assumed that God made it our responsibility to use those gifts to discover what was right. However, I could see how it was possible that the praiseworthy systems of morality that I learned about in my otherwise secular ethics class were independent of the concept of God because there simply was no God. I had always assumed that the reason I'd never encountered any devout Christians who later became atheists was because no true Christian who had seen the power of God with their own eyes could ever become an atheist. I'd always assumed that atheists were never true former Christians, but rather people who were ignorant of the Bible and what it meant to be a Christian. However, the professor knew more about the Bible than I did, and clearly understood every aspect of my Christian life that I had shared with him. He had been a devout Christian, as confident in his own faith as I was in mine, until he had met Ramon Menendez Vidal. The professor was someone who clearly had been a true Christian, and clearly and fully understood Christianity, even valued it, and yet, through research and investigation, had rejected it. So I could see how it was possible that the reason so many people stayed Christian wasn't because there really was a God, but simply because they just didn't know about the things that the professor had shown me. I'd always assumed that the Bible's origins were unknown to academia, and that we had no reason to doubt that it had been inspired by God. However, through the documentary hypothesis, the professor had shown me that academia had made a well-documented and thorough study into the origins of the Bible, and had come to a consensus about precisely how much of it was put together using human reasoning. Among the evidence they found was a set of clear political goals that served very human purposes. So I could see how it was possible that there really was no God inspiring them, but rather that the Bible was just the result of their own human reasoning. I could see how it was possible that they only thought God was inspiring them, but in reality they were just subconsciously projecting their own personal or societal beliefs onto what they perceived as God in their own minds. I'd always assumed that my own experiences of a personal relationship with God were irrefutable revelations and perceptions of a God. However, I could see now how those experiences could be explained as simply the result of my own psychology. I could see how it was possible that I had simply been running a simulation of God in my own mind. And if both the Bible and the concept of God had come from human origins, then any of the logical arguments that Schroeder had made in his book fell flat. If these things came from humans, then Schroeder's arguments could be explained as coincidences, or like the professor had said, it could just be bad reasoning and he could simply be wrong. And when I looked closely at Schroeder's time calculation, I could see that it was off by a pretty large margin from the actual age of the universe. So I could see how it was possible that Schroeder's time argument could seem plausible without God actually existing. And I could see how it was possible that the entirety of creation existed without God actually existing. The very reason that I had originally needed Schroeder's book to comfort me was because none of the processes I had learned about in my physics or biology classes appeared to require a God to work. So of course I could see how it was possible that they simply didn't. So yes, I could see it. I could see how everything in the universe was explainable without a God actually existing. I could see how all the religious symbols and materials and experiences could have manifested without there actually being a God. I could see how it was all possible without a God guiding or creating or controlling anything. That is all it takes, the professor replied. What did he mean by that? This seemed like an obvious logical mistake to me. Just because it was possible that God didn't exist, that didn't mean God didn't exist. Just because I could see how everything could have happened without God existing, that didn't automatically mean God didn't exist. I'd known from the beginning of this conversation that it was possible that God didn't exist. This was nothing new to me. Yet, over the next few days, something happened in my mind. Somehow, walking through each of my core beliefs and experiences and appraising them fully, and specifically as being possible without God actually existing, had changed something about my perspective. Somehow, walking through each detail and seeing how I didn't need God to explain any of it had changed the way I saw things. What the professor was engaging in my mind was the concept of Occam's razor. Occam's razor states that when faced with two opposing explanations for the same set of evidence, our minds will naturally prefer the explanation that makes the fewest assumptions. So if an event or process can be explained without an extra, superficial element, our minds will naturally shave that element away using Occam's razor. For example, if I heard a loud bump in my closet, I may initially think there's some kind of animal in there, moving around. However, if upon opening the closet I discover that I'd left a box precariously close to the edge of the shelf and that the box is now on the floor, I probably wouldn't think there was an animal anymore. Further, if I looked around carefully in the closet with a flashlight and didn't find an animal, or any evidence of an animal such as hair or claw marks, or any evidence that an animal had escaped the closet, such as a hole in the wall, I probably wouldn't think there was an animal there. In my mind, I have two opposing explanations. One is that an animal knocked the box off the shelf, causing the noise I heard. The other is that the box just fell off the shelf because of natural processes, like a lack of friction and gravity, or the fact that the shelf was tilted. If I wanted to go on believing that an animal had caused the noise, I would have to make assumptions that I have no evidence for. For example, I would have to assume something like the animal had quietly run out of the closet door as I opened it without me seeing it. The explanation that made the fewest assumptions and yet still accounted for all the evidence I had was that there simply was no animal. And so Occam's razor would automatically be used by my mind to shave the animal out of the explanation as an extra and unnecessary element. An animal was not needed to explain the events, and so there was no evidence motivating me to believe that there had been an animal in the first place. It was still possible that an animal had been there, but I had no reason to motivate me to believe that. And, the professor was implying, the same was true for God. Everything I had described to the professor was explainable using the natural world we all knew existed. So what motivating evidence did I really have for adding God as an extra element to the explanation? What motivating evidence did I have for thinking it was necessary to believe in God? As the professor's ideas settled in my mind, I was having trouble denying their plausibility and rational soundness. The sheer force of the logic was becoming difficult to resist. In fact, looking back at this conversation, its entire direction seemed not to have gone the way that I was sure God had revealed to me it would. Nothing I said to the professor persuaded him. Every logical step we took in the conversation seemed to take me further and further away from God. Maybe I had been wrong about logic. Maybe I had been wrong about this conversation. Maybe I had been wrong that God had led me here. Maybe this entire conversation had been a huge mistake. I went to the next room and laid down on the couch with my hands over my face and prayed desperately, begging God to give me something, anything, that could persuade the professor and justify the logical underpinnings of my belief. Nothing came. I was giving up on logic. I rushed back to my computer and replied to the professor's latest email. I've made a choice. If I have to give up on logic to serve God, then that is what I have to do. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess. I know you don't believe it, but I do. Within an hour, the professor replied back. You've made a choice? For Christ's sake, Chris, you're only 21 years old. You have no idea who you are or what you want to do with your life. I was backed against a wall, logically and emotionally. I had no idea what to do. So I called my parents. They could tell I was upset, but they couldn't tell what was wrong. I tried to reason the issue out with my dad. Dad, have you ever wondered if maybe the Bible was wrong? I mean, what would you say if someone told you they had evidence that it was, and they showed it to you? Well, I would tell them that's not what I believe, and if they didn't like it, that was their problem. And if they were going to tell me crap like that, I wouldn't talk to them anymore. But what if they were trying to help you? What if it was true? Jesus told us to live by faith, and that he would bring us salvation. He never said, I will give you the truth. He said the word truth with contempt, as if it wasn't important. But aside from God, truth was the most important thing in the world to me. Spreading truth is exactly what I thought God had wanted me to do with my life. I'd never expected truth and God to be in conflict. I'd never expected to have to choose between them. The dawning reality of this situation was emotionally crushing. I was sure that, as a lifelong Christian, my dad would have a core of faith underpinned in wisdom that could at least start to help me sort through these issues and get back to God. But instead, his answer was only more disconcerting. If anything, it confirmed to me what the professor predicted I would find if I brought the issues up to other Christians. At this point, I was fighting back tears. I talked to my mom. She asked me if I was okay. I said it was about God. Is everything okay between you and God? Yes, I feel closer to him than ever. Strangely, I really did. What I didn't tell her was that the feeling was fluctuating. That one moment it felt like God was holding me warmly in the palm of his hand, and the next, it felt like he had never existed. It's kind of like, you know, when Jesus was being tempted before he was crucified, and he felt like the weight of the world was on his shoulders? What was that place called? What is that place called? I picked up a Bible and began to thumb through it while she was thinking. Oh, Gethsemane. Yeah, it's kind of like that. I didn't want to spread my panic to my parents. I had to take this on my own. I told my mom that I would be okay. I told my dad to keep praying for me. I sat in silence. It wasn't long before my mind broke free of my prohibition from using logic. I started to seriously consider it. What if God had never existed? It was like tearing my heart out to even consider it. Like being dropped into a vat of acid or turning into a vampire. I felt like I was losing the most important thing in my life. As the poison of these ideas coursed through my veins, I tried to resist it, but I couldn't. It just made too much sense. I didn't know it at the time, but I was beginning to enter a stage in my life where I simply couldn't believe in God anymore. No matter how hard I tried, I laid on my couch and prayed again, my hands over my eyes. But it didn't feel like anyone was listening anymore. The next morning, when I woke up alone in my apartment, for the first time in my life, I felt truly alone. As I opened my apartment door, I felt a mysterium tremendum at the spacious and vacuous world that greeted me, like staring into a deep body of water that seemed to have no bottom. This once colorful world now seemed dark, colorless, and frightening, like something dead that had skin draped over it to imitate real life. This feeling of disconnect deepened as I walked onto the bus to go to class. I had once thought that when I looked into other people's eyes that I was seeing God through them. Now, those eyes just look frightening and unknown. What controlled the world if there was no God? What protected me and connected me to other people? The professor once said that I would be like a turtle without a shell if I plunged into this headlong. Now I could see and feel that he was right. As the week passed, my simulacrum of God started to malfunction in my mind. Instead of feeling loving and wise, it felt dark, ominous, and bordering on schizophrenic. It pressed me to do bizarre and random things that just didn't make sense, like putting my backpack on a specific spot of the bench that I was sitting at. More than ever before, I was beginning to believe that this supposed guidance was just the random problem-solving part of my brain all along, trying to fit the guise of an omniscient creator. I tried to ignore this absurd malfunctioning program my brain was running and carry on. In facing this possible reality, My life had become a living hell. Eventually, I emailed the professor about some of what I was going through. "This is normal," he replied. "Sometimes it takes time for the emotional part of the brain to catch up to the logical part of the brain." For the first time in my life, I realized that there was something more important to me than God, and that was truth. And for the first time in my life, I learned that if I had to choose between God and truth, I would choose truth. Before, I had placed God and truth on the same level, as if they were equals. But I now began to realize that truth was necessarily a greater good than God, because it was possible for God not to exist, but it was not possible for truth not to exist. And this made truth God's master and ultimate judge. The state of the truth determined whether God even existed. If God's existence did not match the state of truth, then the entire concept of God was worthless. It would simply fall into the graveyard of false ideas. The truth itself would carry on. Truth did not need God to function. Its potential to transform and shape the world held its own power. But what was the truth about God? Theism defines God as both the creator of the universe and an intervening force in that universe. It also defines God as personal, meaning that God is a person, a being, separate from the universe he created. Having faced my fear of losing God and survived it, I allowed myself, for the first time in my life, to really look at the concept and ask, is this true? Do I really believe this? Given what I know about the world and this definition of God, does this even make sense? And the answer was a resounding no. It didn't. For one, if this being were roaming around the universe, breaking its natural laws, then why did it create those laws in the first place? Further, there just seemed to be no room for this being in existence. Every job that this being was supposed to do appeared to already be fulfilled by some fully explainable natural process. Every step science took forward seemed to leave less and less room for this invasive supernatural being. And this didn't only apply to science. It applied to my everyday life. In order to connect with this supernatural being, I had to actively disconnect from the natural world around me, which, ironically, was the only existence I could verify with my own eyes. This is what it meant for me, as a theistic Christian, to be holy, to not be of the flesh, to not be worldly. It meant disconnecting from the world, and ultimately, I now felt, disconnecting from reality. It had made me feel psychologically unhealthy, and I now realized it had probably contributed to my recent failure in statistics. This was because instead of studying the book in front of me, or asking someone else for help, I disconnected myself from the natural world that books and people existed in order to seek help from a supernatural being. And so, I concluded, I did not believe in this theistic supernatural being anymore. But when I thought about it, there was another way that I had interacted with what I had called God that did not involve disconnecting with reality through rituals like prayer. In fact, in this second way of interacting with God, I fully embraced reality. I embraced every heartbeat, every glance into the eyes of another person, every breath, every thought, and every ray of sunlight. And when I saw these things, I felt like I was literally seeing God face to face. Not a creation of God, not a symbol of God, but the ineffable reality of God itself. This was what I felt was meant by the verse, God is love. This God was not only compatible with the natural world, this God was nature itself. This God was the ultimate form of unity. It was literally everything. This God was not a being, This God was beyond being. This was a God I could believe in. I didn't know it at the time, but this conception of God is called pantheism. Formally, pantheism is the belief that God is the transcendent reality of which the material universe and human beings are a part. I perceive this God, in the form of interactions between the natural world and human psychology, as the true source of my numinous experiences. In fact, the more I contrasted this God with the God of theism, the more I despised theism for preventing me from seeing this greater form of God. After conceptually separating the theistic Christian God away from this new and more pure form of God, I was able to see how ugly it was. This theistic God was a dark force that demanded to be glorified. It demanded its will with an ironclad fist. It had been built and fed over the years by the Christian imagination. They heaped their greatest fears and most bigoted opinions upon it until it took on a life of its own. This God sent homosexuals to hell because it detested their actions. You are not worthy of him. Your understanding is inferior and your logic is flawed. So he is your only redemption. And you damn well better believe every word in the Bible, whether you like it or not, because those words are his. If you didn't, he would fan the flames of hell in preparation for you. He had given you a chance. He had stated very clearly that Jesus was the only way. But you wouldn't listen. His will was divine. His guidance was perfect and perfectly clear. If you didn't know his guidance, it was your fault. You had to fix your sinful life. You had to separate yourself from the world through prayer and beg for forgiveness of that sin. Because you are pitiful and so unworthy and so lost without him. And it was in this God that I saw the last bastion of hell. It became my mission to rid it from humanity. I realized that I had given it life. It had been like a program running in the background of my mind. I had fed and animated this God throughout my entire life. It had no reality of its own, only what I gave it. It was truly nothing, and as soon as I cut off its supply, it began to die. It was me. I had been expressing what I imagined to be the divine will. I had been emulating God. Now I wish I could tell you that after making this fairly lucid observation about the traditional theistic Christian concept of God, that I moved on rationally from there to greater purposes and higher forms of learning. But that would not be the truth. Because that is not what happened, at least not initially. I was convinced that this God was Satan, and that Satan was nothing, literally nothing, completely insubstantial, able to create nothing on its own, or even to exist on its own. And this false God had clothed itself in the majesty of the real God, and if I had the power to stop it, then that made me Jesus. That's right. For 4 very interesting days, I thought I was literally the second coming of Jesus Christ. I began to reinterpret Revelation, which I apparently still felt had some kind of authority, despite the fact that I no longer believed the Bible was completely true. The beast was the God of the Old Testament, the theistic God in its most terrible form. The false prophet had been Moses. People had mistaken Revelation completely. Our actual spot in the prophecy was near the end. The devil was ready to be chained and banished, his manifestation as the theistic God ready to be unveiled, revealing his true insubstantiality, his ultimate nothingness, at which point he would fade from existence, removing the barrier between humanity and the transcendent reality of heaven, which existed fully in the natural world. And the man riding on the horse, the one whose name was known only to himself, that was me. I would never tell a soul of my identity. I would only guide humanity past the barrier in our transcendence and allow heaven to be my guide. Eventually, I emailed the professor about some of my ideas. I never told him that I thought I was the Messiah, but apparently he was able to infer it from the type of language I was using. In response, he gave me a long list of people over the centuries who, just like me, had thought they were the second coming of Jesus Christ. The length of this list and the similarity of their ideas and plans to my own sobered me very quickly. So, I probably wasn't the incarnation of Jesus Christ. In my defense, This all happened almost immediately after my deconversion, which itself occurred in a jarringly brief amount of time, so maybe some insanity was unavoidable. But after moving past that deeply embarrassing detour from rational thinking, I was still very compelled by my new vision of a non-theistic God. Ironically, my first steps out of theism were my first steps into theology and a deeper search for the true nature of God. For several months after my deconversion, I considered myself neither atheist nor theist. This is because, at that time, I presumed that the definition of theism was belief in God, and that correspondingly, atheism was a lack of belief in God. And those stances made no sense unless you first defined what you meant by the word God. Of course, if one meant an invasive supernatural being, then I was an atheist. However, it was also possible to assign the word God to things that obviously existed, such as the entirety of the universe itself, or the creative forces of the universe, where creative force meant everything from stellar nucleosynthesis to human engineering. In respect to these definitions of God, I was a theist. To say that one was an atheist towards these definitions would be patently absurd. It would be tantamount to saying that you did not believe in the entirety of the universe, or that you did not believe in stellar nucleosynthesis and human engineering. And so, I continued with this philosophical stance for a long time, determined to point out to both self-proclaimed atheists and self-proclaimed theists how absurd their position was if they didn't first define their use of the word God. Two people arguing about the existence or non-existence of God were clearly wasting their breath if they didn't first define what they meant by God. However, eventually I ran across the proper definition of theism and realized that atheism was an intuitive negation of theism. So people who were not theists were atheists. These definitions fit the most common debates I saw on the internet as well, where on one side of the debate, there was a Christian theist arguing for the existence of an invasive supernatural being, and on the other, there was an atheist arguing that the Christian's arguments were inadequate for establishing that being's existence. And so, by this definition, I was an atheist. It was a strange, liberating, and slightly amusing experience to realize this. I was an atheist. After all these years of thinking that atheists were cynical, nihilistic, and negative people, I realized that I myself was an atheist. I was an atheist. I repeated the proposition over and over in my mind as I walked through the grocery store on this day of realization. I am an atheist. I am an atheist. Of all people, I, the otherwise lifelong Christian, and relentlessly positive person, am an atheist. This realization blew my mind. At the time, I had never met an atheist who took the same approach to conversation that I did. Even the professor, who was still a very kind person and relentlessly patient overall, was very rough around the edges compared to me. One thing I had noticed about many atheists I had met as a theist, the professor included, was their tendency to commit the appeal to ridicule fallacy. Some atheists I met seemed to do this compulsively, rejecting claims purely on the grounds that they sounded unusual or contrary to common sense. However, I had learned through several examples in my ethics class that common sense, which is usually just an appeal to popular opinion, is not a sound basis for argument. One such example my ethics professor used was the case of Stella Liebeck, who had sued McDonald's because she had burned herself with their coffee. Even bringing this example up elicited jeers from the class about how sue-happy some Americans were, and how ridiculous it was that she would sue over burning herself with coffee. That was, until the ethics professor revealed that, at that time, McDonald's required franchises to serve coffee at 180 degrees Fahrenheit, and that the woman had suffered burns to her thighs, buttocks, and genitals that had required 8 days of skin grafting and 2 years of medical treatment. After the professor revealed these facts, the class sat in a solemn and humbled silence. I personally was shocked at how skewed my perspective of the situation had been before I'd gathered all the necessary facts to truly understand it. This example revealed to me that sometimes, when we casually appealed to common sense, we had the frightening potential to be not only ignorantly uninformed, but also blunderingly cruel to the very people that we would be defending if we had instead withheld judgment before gathering all the facts. As the ethics professor had shown, the problem with common sense, with its knee-jerk criticisms of the unfamiliar, is that it is too uninformed to be reliable. Getting to the heart of unusual claims requires real investigation. And I had seen many atheists compulsively reject religious claims purely on the grounds that they were unusual. To be fair, I had also seen many theists compulsively reject evolution and compulsively accept the validity of religious experiences for the same common sense-based reasons. Over time, though, I did meet atheists with the same approach to conversation as me, people who took great pains to be calm, diplomatic, and fair. I slowly began to realize that I was far from alone in this gentler type of atheism. I slowly discovered that these more soft-spoken atheists were everywhere, and were often quiet people who I had never imagined were atheists and had always assumed were Christian. And something else I realized over time was that even most of the louder atheists had a soft spot when you spoke to them in private. And most of the time they were rude not out of sheer spite, but because of their frustration at having experienced repeated encounters with the logical fallacies that permeated most religious thinking, and their resentment towards the negative impacts that religion had had on society. One stance I grappled with briefly was agnosticism. The stance of agnosticism most commonly means the belief that we don't have enough evidence to know for certain whether or not God exists. This stance seems to have arisen primarily from a mistaken belief that most non-atheists have about atheists. And that is a belief that most atheists are strong atheists, which means the belief that the theistic God does not exist. At first glance, this may seem identical to the definition of atheism I used earlier, which can be restated as a lack of belief in the theistic God. But it is actually very different. In order for one to state God does not exist, they would have to know everything about the universe, and they would have to know that our universe does not contain a God. As the agnostic rightly points out, this is not humanly possible. We are limited beings, and our knowledge and perception are limited to an infinitesimally smaller scale than the entire universe. However, I have never met an atheist who, when pressed, identified as a strong atheist. Rather, every atheist I have ever seen address this issue identifies themselves by the definition I have been using, which is simply a lack of belief in God. Which means that these atheists are not claiming to know that God doesn't exist. They aren't even claiming to have good evidence that God doesn't exist. Rather, they are simply not persuaded by the arguments that theists have presented. They simply have not encountered good enough evidence to persuade them. Atheists in this category can most unambiguously be identified as agnostic atheists, which means they are atheistic because they do not have a belief in the existence of a supernatural being, and they are agnostic because they do not claim to know that that supernatural being does not exist. So, in my experience, basically, all atheists are agnostics, and most agnostics are also atheists since they almost never have a positive belief in God. As a theist, I saw the stance of agnosticism as giving a concession to theism, meaning that since agnostics are not claiming to know that the God of theism does not exist, that they think people are logically justified to believe in him, despite not having solid evidence for him. This is not the case. My own agnostic stance is that, without evidence, people are no more justified to believe in the theistic God than they would be to believe in ghosts, psychics, leprechauns, UFOs, fairies, polytheistic gods, or reincarnation without solid evidence. For the same reasons that we must be agnostic to the existence of the theistic God, we must also be agnostic to the existence of all these things. Agnosticism gives the God of theism no more grounds for existing than it does any of these other concepts and beings.